What do you think it stands for? And who decides the rules for MLA? And why do we follow those rules? So just write a brief couple ideas of what you think for those three questions. All right, so let's talk about this. So what do you guys think MLA stands for? I'll give you a hint that the A stands for association. What do you think the M might stand for? Modern language. You got it right on the first time. Good job. So, that's awesome. So a lot of people don't know that MLA stands for modern language. So who do you think decides these rules that we follow when we're writing? I think it's a bunch of guys in a room.
In an underground cave somewhere. Sit around, they scheme.
All they do is think about how can we make your life miserable. Yeah? So really, MLA, the Modern Language Association, is actually a bunch of professors who consider the way to make your writing most accessible to readers, and that's why we follow those rules. So one word that Gardner threw out earlier was convention. Does anybody know what a convention is? Okay. So
you know.
A convention is a guide for how to do something. So maybe instead of thinking of MLA formatting as a rule, we could kind of think of it as a guide on how to be a better writer. Okay? So, do you know why we follow these rules for MLA formatting?
Well, so that if one of us, if someone were to rip off, if everyone were to disregard the MLA rules about citations, then if one
MLA rules to not plagiarize someone else's ideas. We also use the rules to give credit to the originator of those ideas, and also to distinguish between what is a quotation and what is an interpretation of our own. Does anybody have any questions about why we use it? Okay, so I handed out two paragraphs that I would like you guys to read, and then we're gonna discuss what you notice about each one and which one works and which one kind of doesn't work. Okay, so what did you guys notice between the two paragraphs? What about the first paragraph? What did you notice? Yes, there's no in-text citations in the first paragraph. Both of the paragraphs are, well, technically the paragraph is something that I wrote myself a few years ago as a literary analysis, which is what you guys will be doing. And I took a feminist approach to it. So in the first paragraph, are you guys able to see the point that I'm trying to make? Yeah? Is it more effective in the second paragraph? Yeah. So why do you think that it's more effective in the second paragraph than it is in the first?
Give direct quotes.
Yeah, so I'm using direct quotes to support what I'm trying to convince my readers of. So when we quote into our text, one thing that we need to keep in mind is introducing and explaining our quotes. So one thing I would like you guys to think about is, to remember this, is ice. I'm gonna hand out some sentence starters to kind of get your juices flowing on how to introduce a quotation and how to explain that quotation. So these half pages that I'm handing out are for your reference and for you to keep as you're working with your paper this semester, this quarter, I guess. So I want to show you an example of what I mean with introduce, cite, and explain. So introducing the quote. In chapter 2, Sarah reads the first letter first. She is shocked by the last line. Then the quote is, "I never thought I would fall in love, but I guess I was wrong." Explanation is, "It is only through writing that Jim is able to express himself." So what I would like you guys to do is to grab a computer, and we're going to practice this off of some of the analysis and one of the quotes that you guys pulled on your characters for your book doc, and we're going to add that to the bottom of the book doc. So go ahead and grab a computer. At the bottom of your book doc that you guys had to turn in today, I would like you to write two sentences, one from the character quotes that you guys gave in the book doc, and one from the analysis that you have found in the library recently. And make sure that you're introducing, citing, and explaining. If you want to put ice on the document, you can, if that helps you guide you better in citing. So one other thing I wanted to show you guys, if you wouldn't mind pausing, is in the middle of the second paragraph, I use a very chunky quote. It's about two sentences long. The sentence begins, "De Beauvoir explains the biological and social sciences no longer admit the existence of unchangeably fixed entities that determine given characteristics such as those ascribed to women, the Jew, or the Negro. Science regards any characteristic as a reaction dependent in part upon a situation." In the sentence that follows in my explanation, I only talk about women. So really, I don't need that first sentence. I just need the idea of fixed. So what we can do then is we can just quote what we need. We don't have to quote the whole thing. So De Beauvoir explains that science no longer believes in fixed characteristics, but instead regards any characteristic as a reaction dependent in part upon a situation. So what I would like you guys to do is try not using the whole quote. Try writing the sentence in your own words and only using a part of the quote. Does that make sense?